Our next speaker is also our host, Suzanne Lestone, who I'm sure you all know very well by now. And I won't recite all of her many credentials. We all know she's one of the heavyweights in the field. And her talk today is entitled Relationship of Jewish Law to American Law and American Legal Theorists.
I'm really going to depart an enormous amount from what I wrote, poor Robert. But in order to try to tie a lot of what we've done at the conference together, including to try to follow Nomi, because in fact what Nomi's been talking about is really the subtext for some of the rough observational material that I put into this draft that really is only some factual data on which I'll now draw to tell a story. But before I do that, I do want to owe my own personal thanks, not to myself, but solely to Mark. Because I don't know, and here's where I get Sandy Levinson-like. Mark is a crucial figure in my autobiography. Mark is a crucial figure in my autobiography because 15 years ago he invited me to give a paper at the first Jews in the Law conference, and the upshot of that paper was a study of Robert Cover, but more than just Robert Cover, the kind of use of Jewish law in American legal theory. Actually, if anybody wants, some people ask me for reprints, and I happen to have collector's items. The Harvard Law Review sent me 500 reprints under the name of Sharon Stone, because the article came out, I think, a year after Basic Instinct. And I'm delighted to be Sharon, so I'm giving it to everybody.
I'm as delighted as Richard is. I'm
better than Sharon. So I am not going to replay at all what I wrote in that article, except in a minor way, because what I really want to talk about in a very long way, in a kind of through detours, is what happened to Robert Cover after that article came out, which is going to be actually, I think, somewhat surprising and going to tell a much longer story about what my basic focus is. My basic focus is to return to the notion of Jewish law as a marker of Jewish identity. And it's such a complex marker of Jewish identity for reasons that we've heard about over the last 2 days, including in our keynote address, because it is straddling these two very different definitions of it. One definition of it is as religion, right? And the second is the national cultural law of a people. And under either description, and this is why I do want to try to contrast the Israeli experience to the American one, because I think it's somewhat startling in terms of the role of Jewish law in the academy. Under either description, as we can remember from Asaf's paper, right, it is problematic to attach Jewish law to the state. And this was a major, right, this was the major controversy with the Zionist endeavor. It's problem either description, either as the national cultural law of the Jews or as a religion. As a religion, I don't need to go into it. We can understand why as a religion, right, understood as religion, it becomes problematic to attach it to the secular state in a strong way. But understood as national cultural law of the Jews, right, because religion, after all, is a modern word. It's just a description of something that doesn't really capture the essence of anything. It's just, you know, our kind of post-European university Christianized way of putting things into disciplines, and they're, you know, quite artificial. There's no word for religion exactly in Jewish sources themselves. The closest word is dat, but that means custom or the way of the people. So it's a national law in a sense. It kind of reverts to itself. But in any event, I think, and this relates to what Nomi was saying, one of the ways in which the law was imperfect was, and that's an external description, was that it was unready. It is, for so many years in exile, it was unprepared. Hence the Mishpat Ivri movement, the movement called Hebrew Law in Israel, to try to prepare Jewish law for its eventual reception into the state, because it actually didn't deal with so many problems that one would have needed in order for it to be a kind of functioning system on its own. But not only that, the other reason that it doesn't lend itself well to adoption as law for a state comes, I think, from this deep, deep philosophical division about the nature of the law that Nomi was, I think, beginning to get at. And there are two very different philosophies of halakha itself, which cycle back, integrate, and come and go in very, very interesting ways throughout the jurisprudential history of halacha. One of them is a very strong anti-statist conception, one in which the halacha, in fact, right, is not marked by social order concerns, right, and therefore is a very ill fit, right, with something like the modern state. The second is a very strong statist conception, which is not the exclusive conception, but a strong conception that there is a kind of legally pluralistic system. And that legally pluralistic system contains two domains. There's Torah law, which we might view as kind of the perfect law, and then Torah law itself understands it there to be something within it that is a counterpart to some form of conventional law. Not quite conventional law, and I don't want to use the term imperfect law, but for that, but it's, you know, it's sort of an amalgam of emergency jurisdiction, king's law, communal powers, royal prerogatives, etc. But the upshot of which is that there is this set of, there's a kind of theory of this of the conventional law that's within, right, this larger ambit, either within or coordinated with. That's itself another interesting theoretical issue. But even those, right, who have a view of Jewish law as being multi-layered in this way, multi-dimensional, right, that is composed of a variety of jurisdictions that are coordinated by Torah law, one jurisdiction of which deals with mechanisms of social order, even those who hold to that began to divide in very interesting ways that explains the Israeli experience. Modern Orthodox Zionists thought that this vision could be integrated into a theory of the Jewish state, and that this notion that there is a kind of regime within Jewish law that kind of tracks this notion that there's kind of a carved out separate jurisdiction or various theories of halachic legitimation of the state could be pressed into service in order to draw a strong connection between halacha and the state, but at the same time it actually granted an enormous amount of autonomy to the state in so doing it. And they looked at a 14th century sermon by Rabbi Nissim Garandi, which became the kind of basis for this whole theory, and actually this one sermon became to some extent one of the largest building blocks of in a kind of modern project of revival of some sort of political tradition within Judaism. And they looked to this sermon, which was a very, very, very interesting sermon, which essentially talks about, you know, the sort of emergency jurisdiction, king's law, there must be some source of social order, conventional powers to enforce social order somewhere within the authority of, if not the king, then if there's no king, then successor institutions to the king. And Garandi, in doing so, actually reformulated the notion of religion. He reformulated the notion of Torah and religion into a kind of mysterious ritual that brings down the divine effluence. And so it's a kind of dual, you know, a sort of dual redefinition that goes on at some for some time. That sermon lay in the background, right? It was not a, although you know, there are resonances of this in the work of Maimonides and many of the Spanish, part of the Spanish school, who call it the Royalist school. But so they worked on this notion of integrating. But the notion of integrating paradoxically actually led to carving out an autonomous realm for the state. So the integration part sort of fell by the wayside. The second were the Haredi Orthodox, who rely on the same text and others as authority for viewing the Jewish state as just another state in which Torah law could be set, drawing on all these doctrines of accommodation that have been developed throughout exile, and including on this notion that there's this, you know, part of Torah law that's exempt from Torah rules by its own force because there's a need for conventional order. So you have this very complicated picture of what happens in Israel. But the upshot of it is, as part of this kind of intellectual discussion, the upshot of it is, in the Israeli context, is that it led to paralysis. In a sense, Jewish law became totally demarginalized as a result of these factional splits, both between the Orthodox and between the secular, about how, in, you know, how and in what way Jewish law is in some way relevant to and can support a notion of the state.